When I started CD Baby, when I decided it was a store, it really just did one thing. There were a list of CDs with a buy now button by them, and you could buy the CDs and I'd ship them to you. And that's it. That's all it did. This was actually kind of fun during the dot-com boom. Everybody was, you know, saying, we've got an entirely new business paradigm. This changes everything. This is nothing like the old school. Everything is different now. This time it's different. And everybody's talking revolution and how everything's going to be different now. And people would often call up CD Baby saying, hey, a friend of mine told me about you, so can you tell me what you do? And I'd say, we're a record store. And they'd say, and? I'd say, that we're a record store. And they'd say, so we upload music to you and you? I was like, no, we're a record store. And they'd say, so you burn CDs on demand? I'd say, no, we're a record store. And I'd say, have you ever been to a record store? And they'd say, yeah. I'd say, we're a record store. They'd go, oh, that's it? I'd say, that's it. I'd say, oh, okay, cool. And the funny thing is that during all this kind of blah, blah, cloud, haze of the dot-com revolution and everybody trying to do everything different, I think it actually really helped us kind of cut through the chaos by just saying, we're a record store. It really made it easy for people to tell other people about us. If you just do one thing well, then friends can tell friends, hey, you gotta check out this company, CD Baby. What do? They're a record store. That's it. No kind of, you know, they are revolutionizing the 2.0, blah, blah, blah. So when I started this thing, of course, like all of us, I had no idea what to charge for my service. So I went down to the local record store in Woodstock, New York, which is a tiny little thing, like the size of someone's bedroom. It was the only, I think it was called Rhythms. Yeah, it's called Rhythms in Woodstock, New York. Tiny little place, and on the checkout counter, along with all the other normal CDs, they had a few kind of local artists kind of lined up in display cases on the checkout counter. And I asked the woman, hey, how does it work if I want to sell my CD here? And she said, well, you set the selling price at whatever you want. We just keep a flat $4 per CD sold, and then just come by every week and we'll pay you and show you who bought your CDs. I said, okay, I can work with that. So I went home to my brand new website and I typed, you set the selling price at whatever you want. We keep a flat $4 per CD sold and we pay you every week. And that was it. I just figured if it worked for her, it'll work for me. It doesn't have to be that complicated. So sure enough, and I added one more number, by the way, is because it took me about 40 minutes of work to add a new album into the store to, you know, scan the album artwork and rip the audio clips off the CD and then fix the spelling mistakes in people's bios and use Photoshop on the album art and all that stuff. It took about 45 minutes, so I charged a $35 setup fee. And that was it. Those two numbers, $35 setup and $4 per CD sold, is what took CD Baby all the way from zero profit up to, I don't know, whatever, 50 million or something like that. But the funny thing is, 5 years later, after starting this thing, where I really didn't change anything, I was doing the exact same thing for 5 years. I was just a record store, right? Then I started getting this press once we were successful, and people would write these articles saying, it's a revolutionizing the music business. It's a new revolution in the music business. And the funny thing is, revolution is a word that people only use when you are successful. Before that, you're just a quirky person who does things differently. So the problem is that now we're surrounded by all these businesses screaming revolution. And if you want to start your own company, it's so tempting to think that you have to be screaming revolution too, or that you have to come up with something so revolutionary. But the problem is that if you think that love needs to look like Romeo and Juliet, meaning like if people aren't drinking poison and stabbing themselves in balconies at midnight and tombs and monks and all that kind of stuff, if you think that anything less than that is not true love, then you'll miss out on what could be an amazing relationship that grows slowly, right? And if you think that revolution needs to be war and blood and disruption and disrupted industries and industries collapsing and businesses collapsing and businesses growing out of the rubble, if you think that everything needs to look like that, you'll overlook the simple idea that just helps people better. So what I think people call revolution later when successful, at the time, just kind of feels like uncommon sense. It's when you look at a situation and it seems pretty obvious that it could be done in a very different way that everybody's doing it, and it makes a lot more sense to do things that way, but for some reason people aren't. So that's it. And if you persist with that and it's successful, they'll say that you made a revolution.